speaking for the Brokers Forum, 22 years. Yeah, it's pretty amazing, isn't it? It's always great to come and speak to the South Bay Brokers. You guys have provided me with a platform to basically communicate my my research over the years, and I really do appreciate you giving me the opportunity to present some of my research to you. To just kind of give you an idea of my philosophy, I have three lines of business. I run an academic program where I teach six courses a semester at Golden Gate, USF, San Francisco State, and St. Mary's in Moraga. I have about 180 students that I manage per semester, and I've been able to train them and be able to then provide them as resources, human resources, to my network of affiliated companies and people around me. So if you're looking for some top-notch students, either for internships or for job placement, please think of me, because I basically have gotten that platform set to the point where I have them basically trained and ready to go. Then the second line of business is my affiliation with Pillar 6. It's an independent registered investment advisor platform. I focus mainly, specifically on real estate principals and professionals. I provide the advisory services. I have attorneys and accountants around me that specialize in real estate assets from an advisory standpoint. And then I do the advisory, not only on the real estate side, but also on the wealth management side. I also have a real estate brokerage, commercial brokerage operations, where I deal with transactions in the $10 to $100 million range. So I'm actively involved on the brokerage side too. I don't know anybody that has my capabilities to be able to solve extremely complex issues, not only around the real estate, but also from a wealth and advisory standpoint. I also do consulting and speaking engagements at an economic level to major organizations, real estate organizations, not only in the Bay Area, but also in California and on a national basis. So the research that I'm going to provide to you today is very high level. I'm going to start, you know, at the philosophical and the political level, because the politics is the reality of the situation, and will have a direct or indirect impact on taxation and debt and volatility in the real estate market, but also volatility in the stock and the bond market. And will eventually, if there's volatility in those markets and uncertainty, it will permeate down into the real economy and affect job growth, and will definitely affect real estate performance across the property sectors, property types, and at the individual or at the local level. Always has to disconnect right before I give the presentation. Is Avery still here? Did he bail out?
He stepped out.
No, I think not. Always expect the worst. Okay, so let's keep going. Everybody asked me, when is the next recession? The next recession will probably occur at the end of 2018. Usually there is if you believe in political business cycles, there's usually a recession within the first 24 months after a presidential election, if you go back in time. The last recession in 2008 was the most severe recession post-World War II, next to 1958. in 1928. So you can go back over 100 years. Now there's a higher probability of a recession in the last 5 years of a decade. So it points to 2018. If you add in overstimulus, high debt levels, and probability of loans coming due and the CMBS coming due during that time period, you're looking at higher interest rates. The Fed has already said that they're going to raise interest rates 3 to 4 times next year because of the Trump stimulus. It's usually a flattening in the yield curve, and when the yield curve inverts, the stock market peaks within 12 months and you're in a recession within 24, if you believe in economic analysis and business cycles. The real estate industry is highly correlated to the business cycle, so everything revolves around the business cycle. There's a 90% probability of a recession in the first 5 years of every single decade. So not only would we potentially see a mid-cycle recession by the end of 2018, but we will probably be in a severe recession manifested by emerging market credit defaults, bond defaults, because most of the emerging markets right now are extremely over-leveraged. They've issued massive amounts of foreign bonds to try to stimulate their economies and grow out of it. But the problem is that the debt levels are now 100, 200, maybe 300 percentage points above the GDP. So if we go into a recession in 18 or 2021 through 23, a lot of those economies will not have the tax revenues necessary to be able to pay off the interest on the bonds. So they will go into default, or they will go back to their bondholders and renegotiate haircuts on the bonds. Those bonds sit on the balance sheets of a lot of sovereign funds, banking institutions, and pension funds. And when you have to write down those loans, you have to write off a lot of capital on the right side of the balance sheet, on the liability side. That's what happened the last time. So the Fed and the Treasury basically underwrote the last financial crisis. It cost us basically $10 trillion to basically bail out the banks and the system. We don't have another $10 trillion to bail out the system. And we're now at basically a we're now at basically a $20 trillion of debt at the federal government level. That will probably grow to $30 trillion under the Trump plan, and it was already going to increase by $10 trillion anyway under entitlement pressure. So you're basically looking at $30 to $40 trillion in total government debt within the next 10 years. And I do not think that the economy has the carrying capacity to be able to do that. Okay, the debt levels are just out of control at the federal level here in the United States, but also in other markets across the world. So the next financial crisis and the next recession will definitely occur between 2021 and 23. That's only 5-6 years. That's only 5-6 years from now. 2018 is over the next 12 to 24 months. So the question is, what are you doing right now to basically put in contingency plans or defensive strategies to be able to weather the mid-cycle correction, but also the next severe recession? You have to be thinking about that now, okay? Because it's not that far. And it usually takes a year or two to basically restructure your portfolios and put the contracts in place, and then to be able to advise your clients on maybe now's a good time to consider liquidation, or to 1031, or into getting into other types of assets that will be allow you to immunize the portfolio and to be able to hedge off the downside risk that could be coming at the end of 18, but definitely in 21 through 23. And that's basically the reality of the situation that we're working in today. We live in a bubble here, in Santa Clara County in particular, and in the Bay Area. We are seeing weakness in Salinas right now. They're actually losing jobs, and there's been a massive deceleration in job growth, not only because of labor supply constraints, but also we're starting to see some layoff announcements from firms, not only in tech, but other related areas. I do believe that the apartment market has already peaked, pricing peaked at the end of 14 and into 2015. Occupancy rates are still very high. Rents on an effective basis have been at a peak and are falling in San Francisco as new supply comes online. and pricing and rents have peaked in Silicon Valley also. At some point, you just can't continue to raise rates 20% or 15% or 10% per year over a four-year period. At some point, the renters just can't afford to handle those rent spikes anymore. So we've kind of, I think at this point, I've reached the peak, and we'll probably decelerate over the next 24 months as interest rates start to go up. And interest rates have been going up. They're going up, they've gone up, they're going up. Okay, and I'll show you the evidence behind that. That's kind of everything in a nutshell. My disclaimer is I've done the best I could on the research, and I'm not making any product recommendations in regards to financial products or strategies. If you're interested in sitting down with me on a one-on-one basis, I can design a strategy for you, but I'm not making any recommendations. It's based on my own personal experience. Real estate investment is just like big wave surfing. You have to be trained. You have to be really smart. You have to constantly train. You have to position yourself correctly to be able to get the waves. You have to be able to ride the waves. And you got to be able to get off the wave and then paddle back out and get another one. But sometimes a 60-footer will come through and totally take you out. You'll either drown, or since you have experience and you're in shape, you'll weather the closeout. You'll be able to come back up, paddle out, and do it again. So I look at basically life and investment similar to big wave surfing. And that's not me, but I tell everybody. That was Mavericks in 2010. These guys were surfing 50-footers, this is probably a 30-footer. And they were surfing 20 to 30-footers, and when the 60-footers came through, it totally took everybody out. But these guys didn't do it again. It was really amazing. So if you look at I like to start on the world basis, what's going on in the world? Because we are directly impacting not only other countries, but other countries impact us. And I look at these other countries as leading indicators, the canary and the coal mine, of what potentially could happen not only here, but the effects that could affect us. So obviously, we went through the election, and I think as the hearings go on over the next few days, we'll have a good view of what the composition of the cabinet will be. We already know who these guys are and what their policy and philosophies are, both economically and socially. And they will definitely have an impact over the next 4 years on the environment and on capital markets and on every aspect of our lives will be affected by these individuals over the next 4 years. Brexit was a major event. The 10-year treasury dropped to like 1.2, 1.3, the lowest. It was a great buying opportunity on the equity side. And the 10-year treasury is up almost 100 basis points since then. So if you didn't lock in your loans or refinance at that time, the window is actually closing very quickly. Merkel in Germany, she's going to have political issues when she reruns because of the immigration issue and just the politics around that. And those are mostly Syrian migrants coming up from the war. And so that and her stability will be in question. Francis Hollande in France is getting attacked from the extreme right. We'll see if he can hold on to his presidency. They may actually dissolve the parliament at some point if they can't put together a coalition. Parliamentary democracy is very different than representative democracy. Representative democracy is winner take all. Parliamentary is proportional, and then you have to negotiate with the other parties to put together your government. And they actually dissolve very quickly if they can't lead. Have the credibility. In Italy, potential banking crisis seems to be emerging. They alleviated that, but again, it's probably going to cost the EU or the central bank, you know, billions of euros to be able to bail out the Italian banking system, which could have an effect on sovereign bonds. Alexis Tsipras in Greece. Again, Greece is a basket case. They're tied to the euro. They can't devalue their currency. They're under austerity. It's a very small economy in economic terms, but again, it gives you kind of an idea of the post-financial crisis issues that these countries are going through. Spain just has a new president, too. They were in a recession. They were a basket case. Got hammered by the financial crisis and the housing crisis, political instability. They're still in a recession. Russia's expansion into Syria and into, they actually even took over Georgia, they took over Crimea. Very hostile, dangerous government, expansionary, and it looks like there may or may not be direct connections between our current president and its administration and the Russian government. In Turkey, basically martial law, almost a coup, but again, Erdogan had gone in and basically established martial law and basically incarcerated hundreds of thousands of people that may or may not have been involved in it. The coup, and again, Turkey is one of our major allies in the Middle East. So again, very touchy situation there. Saudi Arabia, again, is being attacked by ISIS at its southern border. Again, major oil exporter, but again, you know, the royal family is trying to keep its power structures in place as it's being attacked by all sides. Egypt, a failed state. Sisi took over as an authoritarian ex-military. They have a banking crisis that's going on right now, too. Obviously, Syria, failed state. Libya, failed state. Iraq, failed state. Afghanistan, failed state. Pakistan, unstable. Latin America, Mexico, with Peña, he actually alienated most of his constituencies in the last presidential elections by having Trump meet with him. So there's issues in Mexico along with crime. You have Brazil has a new president. The current outgoing president is being impeached currently, and again, during a recession. Argentina, hyperinflation, political instability, Venezuela. You have thousands and thousands of percent of inflation where their currency is completely devalued. You now have their people rummaging through garbage, trying to get enough food to basically survive. Amazing that country hasn't exploded yet. Southeast Asia, China. China's where it's gonna, the black swan event is gonna come from. Massive amounts of corporate debt financed by their government-sponsored corporations, massive amounts of sovereign debt, and it's gonna explode at some point. And that'll basically take us all down at some point. Japan, a basket case. Currency is appreciated significantly because it's basically one of the only stable places in Southeast Asia. And people in China are getting out. There's been massive capital flight out of China into the United States and other areas, particularly into negative interest rate bonds in Japan. And Japan has basically been in a recession for 14 years. Overstimulation, just can't seem to get out of it because they have massive amounts of debt. Their banking system was over-leveraged, and a lot of these banks are zombie banks, still, that are being carried on the books. Hong Kong, Singapore, Malaysia, political instability, North Korea, obviously showing hostility towards the United States. They actually fired a couple of missiles within 100 miles of Hawaii and of Japan and off South Korea. So political instability in North Korea. Australia, actually one of the more stable, they haven't experienced a recession in almost 20 years. A very well-managed economy, seems to be holding up very well, but if Asia goes, Australia goes, and New Zealand will go with it. And then Southeast Asia, the ANC basically has thrown out, a new government, again, total basket case, corruption. So that kind of gives you an idea of what, where we are as kind of an island of the political and global instability that's going on globally.
So how is some of the areas fine?
For now until the 20th.
Oh yeah, it's kind of getting, so in comparison to other times, is this drastic or kind of normal?
Yes, there's a lot of instability globally. Politically and economically, and a lot of it was due to manifestations of the financial crisis, because the financial crisis was a total dislocation economically and socially, and it's now starting to manifest, you know, 9 years later, politically and economically around the globe.
That's a great question, because I have friends that tell me the same thing, like there's always been instability.
It's political economic now. Okay, a lot of these were emerging markets at some point. Brazil was an emerging market that was growing very rapidly and actually held up fairly well, but then the politics set in, corruption set in, and then you had institutions of power that started to collapse. And then that manifested into...
Well, there might be two or three things going on in the world. There just seems to be a lot more...
There's more.
...built up and converging.
There's more where I'm studying it more. It's probably I'm studying it more.
Was this caused by central banking?
What is all this? Yeah. It was basically a lack of oversight and deregulation of the financial institutions that basically they manufactured bad product, financial product, derivative product, and then at one point all of those trades unwound, and the banking system was basically collapsing under insolvency, and there would have been massive runs on the bank if the Federal Reserve didn't step in and print $5 trillion and clean up their balance sheets.
So where's this going?
At some point in time, like I said, there's going to be $30 to $40 trillion of debt sitting on our balance sheet, and we will not have enough money coming in tax revenues to pay off the interest on the debt. We will default. And then that will permeate. It won't happen here. It will probably happen in some of these emerging markets or these foreign markets first, because they don't have the strength, the financial institutions that we have, and they don't have the economy that we have. So their institutional arrangements or frameworks or platforms are weaker than ours, and that's where it's going to manifest.
That's what we've seen in Venezuela and all different places first.
Pardon?
Is that what we've seen in Central America first?
Central America, Europe's very weak and fragile, Asia's weak and fragile, Latin America's weak and fragile, Africa's weak and fragile, and at some point in time the institutional arrangements just are not strong enough to keep it up, and something happens, and then it permeates. It could contage throughout the world and then eventually affect us. But we've been beneficiaries of the uncertainty because there's been massive capital flight from other countries into the United States, into the US dollar, which has caused the dollar to appreciate, into treasury securities, which has caused the bond prices to go up and interest rates to go down, and have basically provided us with the stimulus of low cost of capital that has allowed us to be able to benefit from that capital flight.
And print.
What?
And print.
And we've been printing a lot.
Comparison to the foreign currency crisis, how many countries do you see going to jump on bond status?
To go in what?
Jump bond status.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
How many countries do you see?
Greece is already there. Spain was there. I'm concerned about Japan. I'm concerned about China. So I'm watching them really carefully.
So are we looking forward to massive inflation in the U.S.?
We're already seeing inflation, particularly in non-discretionary. If you have kids, you have a family, your healthcare costs have been going up 10% per year for the last 10 years. If you're funding private or public education for your kids, that's been going up 8 to 10% per year. Food costs are going up the same. The real inflation rate is 10%, but the headline number from the Bureau of Labor Statistics is probably 2 to 3%. So they're totally underestimating and undermeasuring the true inflation rate. So it's already there. And inflation expectations have increased significantly since the Trump won the election, because we're anticipating massive fiscal stimulus going forward over the next 12 to 24 months if he's able to finance his $1 trillion infrastructure program. That will be stimulative on the fiscal side. So not only has inflation already started, but with the fiscal stimulus, it will exacerbate inflation expectations, causing interest rates to go up. And if the Fed is raising interest rates at the same time, usually the Fed will raise interest rates too aggressively, flatten the curve, invert the yield curve, and once the yield curve inverts, we're in a recession within 24 months. It happens every single time. And that's why I watch interest rates and the yield curve. It's been the number one predictor of recessions for the last 20, 30 years. Okay. Efficient real estate and security capital markets require strong public and private sector collaboration, disclosure of government and corporate financial conditions, and institutional and individual investor confidence in both the financial and political institutions. If you do not have this, and I wrote this in 1996, if you do not adhere to this, what you will have is a misallocation of resources. You will have underproduction, underemployment, low and falling real wages, and low and falling standards of living. And I would say that based on the election outcomes and the composition of the populace that voted for this president, we have basically seen falling in low standards of living and social welfare for the majority of the population in the United States. And there's been a populist uprising that has been reflected in the last presidential election. And we'll see what happens. But there will be direct and indirect impacts on the value of real estate. There will be. Either it'll be beneficial because it'll be capital flight into the durability of that physical asset away from stocks and bonds, or at some point in time, real estate asset prices will also be subjected to the popping of the bubble because there's been massive amounts of capital flowing into commercial real estate, in my view, well beyond the underlying fundamentals to justify the price. Real estate is an extremely complex asset class. I think we take that for granted. To be able to predict the value of the equity, the value of the real estate, you have to understand not only the managerial and financial accounting and the financial ratios and statements to be able to go into the capital markets to raise the capital, either through bank or debt, for equity financing, to be able to acquire that asset. So you have to not only understand the accounting, you've got to understand the finance, you got to understand the capital markets, you got to understand the economics, both fiscal and monetary policy, which will have a direct impact on the value of the real estate. If taxes go up and down, if they go up, values go down, if they go down, values go up. You have to understand interest rates, because if interest rates go up, values go down. If interest rates go down, values go up. So you have to understand monetary policy. That's why we listen very carefully to what Janet Yellen says, and actually she's going to speak next week. I think of the Commonwealth Club, so I'm going to go see that, because it's very important that you understand what monetary policy is going on. And actually, Trump has the opportunity to replace Janet Yellen as the chair, and probably has the opportunity to replace one or two others on the Open Market Committee. So that will have a definite impact on monetary policy. And then we'll talk about fiscal policy too, because he has ideas of lowering personal and corporate income taxes as a stimulus, but actually that doesn't work from a trickle-down or supply-side economic standpoint. The multiplier effect is really low. But from the fiscal policy side, we do the infrastructure. Multipliers are very high for that, not only in the short run, but in the long run. But again, if you spend $1 trillion on infrastructure, the costs are going to be a lot higher because of the bond financing that you're going to use. So over 10, 20, 30 years, the cost of that $1 trillion will probably be at least double or triple or quadruple if you add in the financing costs. The politics is basically the reality that you have to understand now, because policy outcomes will have a direct and indirect impact on the value of your real estate and your portfolio. It will be different by asset class or property sector or geographic location, but it will have an impact on a lot of these policies that are being enacted through the political process at the federal, state, and local level will have an impact, so you have to be monitoring this. And I've actually told everybody over the last 2-3 years within the real estate community that you're going to have to move from the economic and finance and accounting side. This is where we live. This is where we breathe. This is the area that we function in, but we need to elevate our intellect and our ability to analyze and really focus in on the politics and the policy that then become law and administered through the bureaucracy. So we have to elevate ourselves and become political scientists and analysts, because the policies will have a direct impact on the value of your property and your portfolio. So we need to elevate ourselves. Over the past 95 years, society and the economy have witnessed great prosperity, wars, depressions, recessions, and revolutions. We have just witnessed a revolution in political economic ideology, from Keynesianism to monetarism. And in its wake, institutional deconstruction, destruction, and market failure. That was the financial crisis. The question is, what social, political, and economic institutional synthesis will develop, not only from the financial crisis, but now from the political election outcomes? And how will history judge us, and how will we be remembered? We will be remembered as the generation that dismantled regulatory oversight over political, pluralistic institutions that led to the financial crisis, and now has led to the political outcomes that we are witnessing right now. In the next 48 years, you will see another systematic dismantling of pluralistic, democratic, and capitalistic institutions. That is the reality in which we are going to have to exist and invest in.
So is monetarism dead?
Monetarism is now cost us $5 trillion or more. Monetarism is the accepted epistemology and ideology by those who basically govern the economy. It will be a movement back towards some kind of neo-Keynesian model, which it looks like. But monetarism as a political economic ideology will continue to be adhered to and pontificated by the elites who basically run the government and run the financial institutions.
I'm thinking Glass-Steagall and Citizens United when I read that.
Glass-Steagall repealed by Grant Leach 2000 and the Clinton administration. Reuben Summers, all the same guys basically dismantled it. And by 2007, we were in a bubble, asset price bubble that eventually popped in. We went into a recession in 8, 9, 10, 11, and didn't really come out of it until the end of 13 and into 14. The last recession, GDP contracted by 6 to 8%, depending on the measures that you used, and the recession lasted 4 years instead of two. It was twice as deep, twice as long, and still permanent damage to the economy in certain segments and certain geographies across the United States are permanently impaired. They will never recover. They will never recover. And those are the areas, obviously, we want to move away from. Under the current administration, the current people that Trump is picking looks very similar to Trump, to Bush, too. And under Bush's, after 9/11, there was major movement by both parties in Congress and the president in lockstep to systematically dismantle the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. There was a lot of individual rights that were taken from individuals. There was new bureaucracies that were layered in to the federal government, particularly on the security side, and there was, in my view, a systematic dismantling of the Bill of Rights. And it's very similar. I wrote this after Bush 2 and after 9/11, and it's now starting to reoccur. I just added the slide back this morning, where you will see an attack on the media, censorship. You're seeing attacks on the media right now, which is a pillar of our democracy for news, to be able to keep these elites accountable. And you can just see the incarceration and the attack on the media. There's going to be probably more funding for law enforcement and prisons. We will probably not see the closure of Guantanamo. We'll probably see more prisoners go to Guantanamo, which will circumvent habeas corpus and the legal process for individual rights. You will see an attack on women's rights with abortion. You will see that. You will see unification, because it's smart, politically between church and state under the new administration. It looks very, very similar. What happened under Bush 2 will probably happen again under Trump, backed by the Republican Party that controls both the House and the Senate. And actually, he's got a shot at replacing 2 to 3 Supreme Court judges over the next 4 years, because a couple of them are in their 90s. So what happened then, and what I think is going to happen over the next 4 years, is you will see continual institutional deconstruction and dismantling of pluralistic and democratic institutions by powerful interests within society. The goal is to deconstruct these institutions and replace them with new authoritarian institutions that enforce and redistribute private property rights to privileged interests at any cost. And you're seeing it within these nominations. These are all guys with direct ties to basically authoritarian regimes, particularly in Russia. They are elites from the oil industry, and he's already talked about systematically dismantling the EPA, the FDA, roll back Obamacare, roll back Dodd-Frank. And basically, Lawrence Summers, who's an economist out of Harvard University, basically said yesterday that this administration is basically setting us up for the next financial crisis. And usually Summers, you know, I have an issue with him because of what he said about women when he was at Harvard as the president. But I think he's a really good economist, and he's one of the only guys who are actually telling the truth out there. I'll let you read through this, but I do think that the financial crisis basically set off a dialectic of institutional realignment across the globe. And we're basically in the wake of it, even though it was 9 years ago. We will still continue to see institutional realignments between governments, governments and their citizens, corporations, and governments, corporations and their consumers, and their customers. There's a total realignment that was occurring over the last 9 years, and it will happen again over the next 4 years if he gets elected again over the next 8. If you look at what happened, there's been a rightward shift in political and economic ideology over the years, from Roosevelt to Carter to Reagan to Bush 1 to Bush 2, and now obviously the Tea Party, and now you have the Trump administration, which I would say is not right of center, which is where most policies need to be enacted to have a major impact on the majority of the people within the country. You have basically a political party ideology in the executive branch, which in my view is on the extreme right. The society needs to be governed either from the middle or from the right of center, not from the extreme right or the extreme left. If you govern from the extreme right or the extreme left, you will have a redistribution of private property, redistribution of wealth to basically powerful interests that basically control the party. And if you look at the Koch brothers, and you look at others, they have direct influence on the Republican Party. And again, we will be affected by that. If you look at the election, it was the dirtiest election ever. It was completely and utterly unprecedented. The demographics, if you look at the demographics of the population that actually voted for Donald Trump, the majority were white males, both elites, rich, but also middle America, white males. 60% of the voters were over the age of 50 years old. So white male over 50 were the majority of the voter bloc that actually brought him in. 43% were college educated, and actually 30% were Hispanics that actually voted for him, which I thought was really interesting. It was the biggest gender gap in American electoral history, particularly with the attack on abortion. The millennials, those under 35, basically did not participate. The biggest demographic bulge next to the baby boomers with non-participation by basically people under the age of 30. And these will be the people that will become even more and more powerful and more important in 4 years from now and in 8 years from now in the next 2 presidential elections. And we'll see if we'll be able to engage. Over 43%, I think it was 43 or 45% of the population did not even participate in the elections. Okay, so very low voter turnout. And why would they even turn out? A lot of them are disenfranchised, disaffected, and undereducated. I mean, we have less than 30% of the population in the United States is college educated. Where you go into Europe and it's over 70%. So complete disconnect. How do you participate when you don't even have an education? Very low turnout from African Americans. And then if you look at the incarceration system here in the United States, where you have millions of people actually in prison, well, if you get a Felony, you can't vote. Your voting rights are taken away. So actually, Hispanics and African Americans, particularly males between the ages of 25 and 45 years old, are completely out of the political process through prior convictions, which in my view is just another form of institutional racism and incarceration. It created a negative political, social, and economic psychology. I started to see social phobias and paranoias by certain groups of individuals. And actually, 2 days or within 24 hours after the election, I got basically emails from the presidents of the major universities in which I teach at that were telling me about harassment by students that were being harassed by other students because they were Muslim or from the Middle East, female. There were sexual attacks on women on campus, both verbally and physically. It was unfucking believable that it was, in my 20 years of teaching, that has never happened before. You heard attacks on the democratic process and the voting system, which is extremely dangerous because voter turnout would be low and intimidation at the voting booth had basically kept some voters away. And to attack the voting process is extremely dangerous. You saw attacks on the media, free press, and really attacks on liberalism and intellectualism and progressiveness, which is really where we are here on the West Coast and the East Coast have the highest concentrations of basically liberal, intellectual, progressive individuals. So it's basically an attack on not only the people within that strata, but also by geography. And if we get a rollback in Obamacare, if they just out and out reject it, there will be 20 million people without health care. And California will be one that gets hit the most. Because we have about $40 billion that come into the state through health care redistribution from the federal government. So if it's rejected or revised, it could send us into a recession. And if they reject health care and not replace it with something better, roughly 25%, 27% of the economy is in the healthcare industry. So the healthcare industry revamp, or reject, or redesign on a policy basis could be the black swan that triggers the next recession. That's why it's so important to see what these guys are doing in Washington, because it will have an impact on the economy. You saw cultural segregation in the last election, and there will definitely be judicial realignment. If he is able to get the next 3 Supreme Court judges, and he's already got 1 slot because Scalia is gone, but he's probably got 2 more within the next 4 years because 2 of them are already in their 90s. So what happened right off the bat? Well, basically multinational uncertainty. Multinational corporations are really concerned because they can't really plan what to do until the policies move through the lower house and into the Senate, proposed, reconciled, and then brought to the president to either be signed or be done. So there's a lot of policy uncertainty. We saw an instantaneous shift in flattening in the yield curve, which has already affected for everybody. The mortgage have already seen the mortgage rates increase and probably underwriting standards increase too, for particularly commercial loans. You saw a devaluation instantaneously in the peso. Instantaneously. You saw higher volatility in the stock market and gold prices went up. Again, you're seeing capital flight into safe assets because of fear. The overall economic stimulus of the policies will have a positive impact on consumption if you lower personal income taxes. There will be a positive effect on investment if you have lower corporate income taxes. Corporations will probably invest more in CapEx. Government spending through infrastructure and remilitarization would be positive on a fiscal basis. And then the question will be, will the dollar devalue at some point in time because of the very high debt loads that we will incur for these stimulus packages? And the devaluation could actually be a positive because that makes our exports cheaper in the global trade markets. Environmental degradation, deregulation, The guys that he's bringing in to oversee the EPA basically have attacked the EPA over the years, so you'll probably see a rollback of environmental protection and probably see higher air pollution, contamination, and spills, and other negative externalities from the dismantling of the regulation. Multinational corporations are very uncertain. They're holding about basically $2 to $3 trillion of cash outside the United States. Trump wants to give them a 10% tax holiday to bring that money back. But why would you bring the money back if you're uncertain about, you know, the policy implications going forward? So there will probably be lower business investment, definitely with higher interest rates. And again, if the government is issuing $1 trillion more in bonds, and actually a lot of the bonds that have already been issued are going to basically term out, and we're going to have to refinance probably $1 trillion or $2 trillion of current treasury securities within the next year or two. If you have more debt coming online plus refinancing of new debt, there's going to be a major crowding out private investment capital away from the private sector and towards the government. And the government is not a productive institution. It is probably a negative productive institution. The money should be going towards corporations and new products and new investments and productivity in land. So there could be lower employment, higher payouts, lower payouts and retained earnings, lower payouts and dividends will reduce the price earnings multiples and probably cause the stock market to correct. And I'm actually predicting a correction of around 1,000 points in the Dow over the next 2 to 3 months. The stock market is at an all-time high. It's basically bubble territory, and a 1,000-point correction within 3 months is highly probable.
It's only 5%.
Yeah, it's not that much.
That happened every year.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, so buy your puts and write your calls, and you know, do your derivative trades if you believe what I'm telling you. But I'm not making a recommendation. Okay. Lower reparations and earnings back in the United States. Again, if they're uncertain, they'll probably keep their money offshore than to bring it back into the United States. And then there'll be definitely a bigger impact on West and East Coast global trades, particularly the ports of LA. Ports of LA and Long Beach have actually seen their trade decline. We've already seen global trade peak globally. It has been growing at a constant rate, almost a drift for decades, but now it's actually peaked and started to come down. And the Port of LA and Long Beach employ, you know, hundreds of thousands of people within the LA basin. So if trade is actually declining because of an evaluation or revaluation of the dollar, which makes our exports more expensive, and there's less consumption, less imports, it could have an economic impact not only on port-related labor, but also on the industrial sector in the South Bay, down in LA.
Isn't it an oversimplification to look at the decline in global trade while global debt is continuing to go up pretty significantly and assume that's kind of a
problem? Global debt that has been accumulated over the last years has been stimulative in basically getting us out of and putting us in a recovery mode. But the problem is that we cannot continue to print and issue bonds to buy employment and growth. At some point in time, you have to print and issue more bonds, more leverage, to get the bang for the buck in production and employment. And we've reached that point now where the debt levels globally have reached their peak, and it's too costly to basically issue more debt to buy production and employment.
It's too costly, $8 trillion a day.
It's too costly, and the multiplier effect is starting to wane. Mm-hmm. It was easier before to basically issue the bonds, to basically stimulate the economy, but now you've got to issue more bonds
to get the... And you have all that money in the economy, and it's got to go someplace. It's all paper.
Yeah, it's paper.
Yeah.
It's another house.
Do you see us going back to gold back or something back?
No. Because the incentive by the central banks and by the treasury of most, you know, countries is basically to allow the currency to float, one. Two, they want a fiat system in the currency because they can't hold enough gold to basically back the currency. And what they do is they basically print money to create inflation to basically monetize the debt at the fiscal level. So that's why the headline numbers of CPI of 2% and the producer price index of 5% is a total underestimation and undermeasurement of the true inflation rate, which is 10%, which basically means that your wages, your real income, your income has to increase 10% per year nominally to keep up with inflation.
Well,
and if you're not, your standards of living and your social welfare are declining and your real wages are negative.
It wasn't the idea behind the stimulus to expand the economy. It hasn't done that.
It was to stimulate the economy.
Yeah, but the economy is still, what, $15, $16 trillion in GDP?
That's right.
And it hasn't changed since 2008.
No, we've been underproducing for the last, we've underperformed on an economic basis cyclically since 1988.
Yeah.
1989. The last two peaks in the business cycle have been successively lower. So the ability to grow the economy after the recession through fiscal and monetary stimulus is waned because of the debt levels. So if you look at Trump's policies, infrastructure spending, eliminate sequester on military buildup, they're definitely because of the South China Sea and North Korea. Plus, again, military buildup is always very popular in Congress because it's a redistribution of wealth to basically the military industry, which is very significant in places like Seattle and LA, Dallas and Texas and other areas in the United States. He's talked about troop buildup, production of ships, remilitarizing local law enforcement, requiring payments from NATO and Japan and Germany and Saudi Arabia, eliminating sanctions on Russia, and eliminating the definition of waterboarding and torture.
Just want to give you a heads up, it's 9:15, we end at 9:30, so
whatever
you want to come.
Okay, I only have like 100 more slides.
Go for it.
So what I'll do is if you give me your business card, I'll send you the presentation. I would read and study the deck, okay? And then you'll have some information to be able to talk to your clients about, because the presentation not only goes through all of the economics, but I have all the economic data, okay? Since I only have a few minutes, why don't I just hit on some of the highlights of the takeaways from my brain. The Bay Area has created over 100,000 jobs per year over the last 2 years. The job growth because of employment or unemployment reaching its all-time low, if you believe in the unemployment rate. Growth has started to slow significantly year over year as of November. It's basically been cut in half on a percentage basis. So we're starting to see lower job growth, and one is because we're at basically full employment, if you believe the unemployment numbers. There's also weakening in the economy too, which is also causing the job growth to slow down. And because of the uncertainty around the election, and economically, corporations haven't hired as much as they have over the last year as they did over the last 24 to 36 months. Interest rates are definitely going up because of inflation expectations and inflation starting to kick up. And with fiscal stimulus, the bond market is basically anticipating higher inflation and higher interest rates. And the Fed has already said that it's going to raise interest rates 3 to 4 times next year. Usually what happens is the Federal Reserve raises interest rates too much too fast, causes the curve to flatten and invert. And again, the stock market peaks within 12 months, and we're in a recession in 24 months. So I watch the curve, particularly the short end of the curve. There is selling, which is going to have an impact on the yield curve, as you're seeing continuing selling of U.S. Treasury securities by foreign governments, particularly Japan and China. So as they start to sell off their bonds, their U.S. government securities, and issue their own bonds, that will cause the yield curve to flatten, bond prices to go down, yield curve to flatten and could with, in conjunction with rising inflation expectations, issuance of more debt and a sell-off by sovereigns could cause the curve to invert and then trigger a recession. What else? Why don't I take questions? Why don't I take questions, specific questions?
How do you think this will affect the local apartment economy?
Well, you're basically at full occupancy right now. The employment market is starting slow, but it's still very strong. We basically capture 40% of all venture capital here in Silicon Valley on a quarterly basis. In the last quarter, VC raised around $10 billion, and we got 40% of it in Silicon Valley. And actually, California captures around 50% of all venture capital raised per quarter in the United States, so that's really positive. The sector that's getting the majority of the money is really applications and apps and software, and that will continue to be a strong sector, along with medical devices and energy will continue to get a significant portion. We have a comparative advantage here, particularly in the Valley, and now in San Francisco and in the Bay Area. We have in-migration and out-migration. Immigration, which is causing the population to grow. Out-migration of usually highly skilled, highly technical individuals. They come here first. They basically work 10 years, 15, maybe 20 years, and then arbitrage their human capital by going out of state because they can lower their living costs by 30% and be able to buy a house and basically retire if they do it right. So we have comparative advantages here that a lot of places don't have. The biggest costs here are going to be housing costs. And actually, a lot of the tech companies are looking for satellite destinations to expand their businesses, such as Portland, Utah, Phoenix, maybe Tucson, not really. San Antonio, maybe not really. They want to be close to California within a one-hour flight, and they want to be within the western region. So you'll start to see more satellites start to break down. Infrastructure costs and congestion is really higher. I mean, the amount of traffic has almost doubled within the last 9 years without any improvements to road infrastructure. So you have high transportation opportunity costs due to congestion. And then housing costs, too. Again, we need supply. We need adjustments to the zoning codes. We need smart planners and urban planners and government. And there needs to be some kind of reconciliation between the private developers and the planners to be able to come to consensus on how do you develop and redevelop urban areas that will take into consideration environmental congestion and cost to be able to grow highly productive labor forces within certain geographies. Did that answer your question in a long way?
There was a statistic last night that they had over 400,000 new residents coming to the Bay Area, and I guess like the last 5 years, and they built less than 80,000 houses.
Yeah, there's
one house for six.
There's basically, even with new supply coming online, it's not enough. It's not, so it's got to come from the policy level. Mike, and then I'll take round one.
With the end of the year predictions on the Fed rate increases for this year, do you shift your opinion now that the makeup of the voting members has actually shifted more dovish with the January shift?
Inflation expectations is kicking up, and now there's been a movement from monetary policy to fiscal policy to stimulate. So basically, the Fed has the opportunity now to exit, which it did when it basically stopped doing QE about a year ago. This basically gives them carte blanche to start liquidating their balance sheet, and they've already sold off about $1 trillion of the $5 trillion that are sitting on the Fed's balance sheet. They want to unwind that thing. This is now the opportunity to unwind. And if they start to sell off and liquidate the treasury securities on their balance sheet, that's going to cause bond prices to go down and interest rates to go up. So the selling by foreigners, the selling by the Fed, higher inflation expectations, higher guidance by the Fed to raise interest rates. I mean, they're basically laying it out for you. Call your clients right now. Tell them this is the time to buy. This is the time to refinance. If you don't do it, you're going to get squeezed at some point. Did you have a, you had a question? No? And then Raul? And then, go ahead.
I appreciate all those input. In addition to higher taxes, is the investors team, will be seeing more control by the government in terms of rent control?
Definitely rent control around here, but I know some of them got shot down and some of them were actually enacted. In regards to, and a lot of the taxation, increase in taxes didn't get voted through, so there's now budget gaps at the local and the state level, which are going to have to be made up. At the federal level, they will probably pass through the two houses because they're controlled by the Republican Party. They will probably be able to push through pretty quickly reductions in personal and corporate income taxes in the short run. But at some point in time, if you're going to add another $10 trillion over the next 10 years to the budget, you're going to have to raise taxes. And who's going to get hit through higher taxes? Higher income individuals are going to get hit. And definitely real estate is going to get hit. And there could be an attack on the 1031 exchange. There could be an increase in the capture tax and in capital gains tax at some point in time. Transfer tax, if they eliminate Obamacare, that gets rid of the Obama tax. But again, the short-term stimulus from tax reductions will not have a major impact on stimulating the economy because the multiplier effect is really low when you cut taxes. But what it does is it basically sets up us to raise taxes in 4 to 8 years now, from now on corporations, high net worth individuals, and real estate. So it's coming, okay? You can't double the debt from 20 to 40 trillion in the next 10 to 15 years and not have to go back and repay it. At some point in time, you're gonna have to pay the piper, and that's gonna come through higher taxation. Did that answer your question?
Santa Clara County apartment rents 1 year at the end, 1 year from now, and cap rate.
Rent on an effective basis or on a face asking
on the rent. Asking.
Perfect.
Same store asking rent 1 year from now versus today.
Probably say 3 to 5%.
Up or down?
Up, but on an effective basis, probably flat.
After bonus, you mean moving?
After and concessions and stuff like that, if you take into rent concessions.
Is it cap rate?
Cap rates, if interest rates are going to go up, cap rates are probably going to go up, if there's a correlation. The problem is that theoretically there's a correlation between cap rates and risk-free rates, or cap rates and interest rates. So if interest rates are going up, the cap rates theoretically should go up. The question will be is with the currency controls from China, because a lot of the money has been coming in, particularly into apartments, for all cash deals have been foreign money. If they start to impose the currency constraints, a lot of that capital flow out of China into real estate assets here in the Valley will probably slow or stop significantly. The question will be, will there be a flight to safety into real estate assets, particularly apartments? I would probably say yes, because real estate apartments are the best asset class of all the property sectors in providing the highest risk-adjusted rate. You have demographics, you have economics, it's people, you can lower the rents, fill the apartment building. Can't do that with office, industrial, retail. So the question will be, what's going to be the counteracting influences? Will it be continued capital flight into real estate apartments and the Valley that will keep cap rates low? Or will be there be an upward shift in cap rates due to higher interest rates? And then maybe at some point in time, you've pushed your rent so high that you basically are starting to create economic vacancy within your properties, and you're going to have to start lowering your rents to keep your occupancies at the 95% level, which is the optimal level to rent your apartment properties with enough turnover.
Larry, if you had, you personally, knowing what you know, had $2 million and you had allocated to invest in a
building,
he called me.
In buildings and everything.
Where and when would you invest that?
In everything or just in real estate?
No, apartment buildings. Would you invest it here in this area? And when would you place that investment?
Well, again, you know, I'm a submarket person, okay, not a general market person. So the question is, where specifically would I invest in apartments?
Yeah.
I could start in Seattle. I like the east side and downtown. In Portland, I like Montgomery County. I like Intel. Maybe downtown, but probably close to the tech centers. In Northern California, I was going to go into Sacramento. I'd go to Davis, definitely. Maybe downtown. And if I wanted to do more a commodity play, I'd probably go up into Roseville, Rockland, and Lincoln. In the Bay Area here, supply constrained markets, I would, if you want to deal with constraints, maybe Santa Rosa, maybe Napa, you know, get a commodity, get higher yield, but again, you have transportation constraints up there. San Francisco is a whole different ballgame. Brass knuckles to be able to manage in San Francisco. In the East Bay, again, if you're a commodity player, you know, maybe Cornell would be an entry point to get yield. If I'm going to be in the Bay Area, I'd like the 680 corridor, maybe Concord, but definitely Pleasant. Down to Pleasanton. Would love to be in Alamo, Danville if I could. Walnut Creek's a different play, but again, primo, class A submarket. In the East Bay, Oakland's a different basket. You're going to have to do a political, social, economic analysis of Oakland because it's really tough. You get your arms around Oakland. But if I did, I'd probably want to be in Montclair if I could get in there. Maybe North Berkeley would be a great place to be. Emeryville, if there's even any product there. And then when you start going south from there into Hayward and San Leandro, San Lorenzo, the demographics change pretty quickly along with the products. So that's a value add play there. Union City, emerging market, Fremont, as close to Tesla as possible. Again, if there's even product there, and then you want to take some risk, you could be on the east side, Santa Clara, and again, primo, blue ribbon, class A submarket, basically from Stanford, you know, all the way down into Willow Glen and probably west side, if I could get in. And then I would do Scottsdale in Phoenix. I would do Salt Lake and get close to the university or the medical center or the airport. To get close to these growth poles that will create economic occupancy where you can reposition the asset and appeal to a certain demographic and make your money through the value add process. I'm not a Tucson, I'm not Albuquerque, I'm not a fan of Texas or the South or the Midwest or the Northeast. I'd rather play in my backyard here than to go to other markets to chase yield and chase lower credited tenants that could come back to haunt me when we go into a downturn and I have to fill my building up with lower credited tenants and end up ruining the value of my property.
All right. Thank you.
Give me your business cards. I'll send you the deck and a lot of the data that's in the deck. I have all the references too. So if you want to go back to the source documents, you can go back to the source documents. Okay. And then I'll pass out my, once you pass around my cards, sir. And if you guys need any wealth or investment management advice, I'm available to talk to you about your family and to help you protect yourself.
Next month we have Steve Seligman from Marcus & Millichap. One of the biggest real estate investment firms in the nation, the number one office for Marcus and Millichap were at. They trained me, my CEO, he was my senior agent, really good guy, very knowledgeable. We'll be talking about how to run a successful brokerage company and about the local apartment economy as well. Hope to see you next month. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Yeah.